And today we're going to continue moving towards the end of the Gospel of Thomas, working with three translations, Marvin Meyer, Thomas Lambden, I believe it's, I think it's Thomas Lambden, and Andrew Bernard, with an interlinear from the Coptic to Greek English literal. And we'll start saying 90, and there are a total 114, so we'll probably take 2 weeks and I think be able to finish. And what I see is this is Gnostic Christianity. It's not quite the same as something like Valentinian or Marcionite Gnosticism, talking about Demiurge and Archons. That's not what we've got here, as anybody who's been following knows. This is actually a Gnostic-related version of some of the passages that are found in the New Testament, which today, you know, suffer from centuries of reinterpretation or retranslation, and originally were codified in the Council of Nicaea in the 4th century, and other councils in the 4th century also, there were others, that basically determined what's orthodox and what's to be excluded. This is very New Testament related. So 90, saying 90, Yeshua said, "Come to me." This is starting with Marvin Meyer translation, then Lambden, then Bernard. Yeshua said, "Come to me, for my yoke is easy and my mastery gentle, and you will find rest for yourselves." And Lambden's version goes, "Jesus said, come unto me, for my yoke is easy and my lordship is mild, and you will find repose for yourselves." And this is to the disciples and to those who would be interested in joining or following or taking to heart what Yeshua was saying. And so we've got two things here. We've got three real points. My yoke or discipline is easy or gentle, and my lordship, meaning Meyer put mastery, me being your lord is sort of what he's saying, my lordship, which doesn't have the same necessarily association as we have today. You know, lordship sounds like a slave master slave relation, not necessarily. One of the terms for Gautama is Bante in, I believe, Thai or Sanskrit. Thai, certainly they use the term Bante, B-H-A-N-T-E, which sometimes is translated as Lord or Sri, like Sri Aurobindo, S-R-I, Sri Nisargadatta. Sri sometimes translated as Master or Lord, but it doesn't mean slave master. And the third statement is about you'll find rest. And let's look at the interlinear and we'll be able to pull it together. It's not so complicated what's being said here, but there are important principles. From the interlinear 90, says Yeshua, "Come you unto me, for a naturalness is my yoke, and my lordship a person gentle is, and you shall find a repose for yourselves." And so Gautama also spoke to prospective monks and said, "Ehi bhikkhu." Ehi bhikkhu means come monks, or come you who may become a monk. Naturalness is my yoke. And Bernard translates that as, "My yoga is natural, and my lordship is gentle." You can say that spiritual yoke is yoga. That's the root. The Sanskrit word yoga is the root. The root of is yug, which is a Sanskrit root or Indo-European, even Proto-Indo-European, PIE, etymological root to the word yoke. Yoga is a yoking of the mind or mind-body to spiritual discipline and practice, particularly harmlessness and, development of samadhi for prajna or awakening. Starting with morality, you can say that the training, Gautama talks about his training all the time. The yoke or discipline, spiritual discipline training is natural. And this is a really actually very important principle that if one's spiritual practices don't become natural, then there'll always be a chafing at the yoke, meaning there'll always be frustration, resistance, and some kind of a love-hate relation that we have to our practice or to that which we think or feel or know will help us. And so, in some sense, if you go against your desires, even if your desires are not what you think they ought to be, there's going to be perpetuation of internal conflict. I should, but I don't want to. I'll make myself because I think I should, but I don't really want. In the end, the person drops it and can't continue. Meanwhile, if certain desires are harmful to self or other, one is enlisting for more suffering. And so, it's a gradual, I think, adjustment of both practice and the mind commitment or commitments to practice. And the practice could be countless: practice of meditation, dietary practice, sleeping, sexual, celibacy or not, or whatever, study, going to therapy every week, whatever. There are all sorts of things that we sense can help us or have helped us, and yet we chafe against continuance. That's normal, but it's a bad idea to bite off more than you can chew. And like Gautama's analogy of not too tight, not too loose, tuning the string of the lute. If you hold your practices too tightly, you're going to hurt yourself. If you hold the practices too loosely, you won't benefit from them. And so, this assurance that my yoke is a naturalness, what he's asking of people, is not galling limitation, as I Ching puts it, Chia, hexagram 60. Same thing. So I Ching, hexagram 60, says, is named limitation in the Wilhelm Baines version, which is the best version of I Ching, I think. Limitation is very helpful, but galling limitation should not be persisted in, persevered in. And so some limitation is very helpful, but if limitation, the degree of self-limiting goes beyond a certain point, it becomes galling and very bitter. And people have hurt themselves, mind, body, by galling limitation, too tight practice, too tight yoke, self-disciplining of mind, body. And so this is a not a little point. And then my lordship, a person gentle, is me, as teacher, is gentle, not punishing. And the best teachers are gentle, actually. The kick-ass teachers themselves have not gone beyond that. Meaning, there are some hard-ass teachers, and sometimes a teacher should be with an advanced student, but they'll know. The advanced student knows that it's not sadism; it's limited application of stringency or harshness. But it's appropriate. It's my Roshi once said something like, even though he was a scoundrel, he also was a good teacher. And he said something like, only the fast galloping horse gets the whip. And that's true. So, for an advanced student who's galloping fast at the time, a whip may help, but it's not sadistic. So, you gotta be careful with that. And some teachers who are scoundrels play that game. So, anyway, there's a lot to find here, and a rest. You shall find rest. And in the end, we really can't long-term commit to and perform spiritual training and practice unless there's tangible benefit felt, including a kind of repose or increasing wellness, increasing rest of body mind. It doesn't mean non-activity. It means peace and ease of mind body. And if that's not the effect, there's a problem somewhere. 91, Meyer to Lambden to Bernard, 91. They said to him, "Tell us who you are so that we may believe in you." He said to them, me Yeshua, "You examine the face of heaven and earth, but you have not come to know the one who is in your presence, and you do not know how to examine this moment." Very deep. This may have been who was speaking to Yeshua, I don't know. They're basically saying, "Tell us your name, or your position, or your rank, or who you represent. Then we can believe you." Which is also a funny kind of thing. It's like, oh, he's wearing a robe, I must trust him. Oh, he comes with a title. Oh, I must trust him. Or then we can believe in you. Some silly folk once upon a time on YouTube wrote, "Well, tell us what, tell me what degree, what are your academic degrees and from what university you got it? Then I'll listen to your talk." This is a person who doesn't trust themselves. So you trust the outer, you forget the inner. And Yeshua was saying, you study the outer appearance of heaven and earth, or the book learning teachings regarding the universe and humanity or the laws of earth, but you don't even know who I am in front of you, because you can't feel, because your heart is blocked, and you don't know how to examine the moment. So there's a limitation in discernment and receptivity. From Lambden, 91, they said to him, "Tell us who you are so that we may believe in you." He said to them, "You read the face of the sky and of the earth, but you have not recognized the one who is before you, and you do not know how to read this moment." It's a very nice phrasing. Read this moment, examine this moment. You don't know how to see now. You can't see what's in front of you. And so, let's go to the interlinear, 91. Say they to him, "Tell it to us, you who, so that we shall do to trust thee." You who are you? Says he to them, "You act to examine the face of the sky with the earth, and he who you're in face presence of forth, did not you recognize him? And this moment you recognize not to act to inquire of him." A little convoluted. Lambden, or not, Bernhard translated it as, "They say to him, 'Tell us who thou art,'" meaning tell us who you are, so we may believe in you. He says to them, yeah, these guys, translators are often frustrated authors. I've met many translators who don't seem who seem to have this urge to be a creator, while their role is to translate. They don't realize the creativity, or they're frustrated in not having the creative license that they would have as an author, and don't really have as a translator. So they translate creatively. So Bernard says, "You scrutinize the face of the sky and of the earth, yet you have recognized him who is facing, you have not recognized him who is facing you, and you do not know how, you do not know to inquire of him at this moment." capital H for him. Please. You know, there's so much human overlay. I mean, humans, the 3D repeaters are nearly incapable of pure reception transmission of truth without personal overlaying and filter-biased, individualistic fashioning upon it. How about we go tight with the interlinear? Say they to him, meaning Yeshua. Tell it to us. Tell us. You who? Who are you? That's what they said. Who are you? So that we can trust you. So that we shall trust you. So you tell us who you are and we'll trust you. What does that mean? So how about we will listen and evaluate the truth and importance of what you say, then we'll know to trust you. They don't think that way. They want to know who you are, what's your title, where are you from, who do you represent. And says he to them, you act to examine, your actions, by action you examine the face of the sky with the earth, not necessarily and the earth, but the sky with the earth. You're examining all these things in a theoretical way, but, and, he who's in your face, or in the face, in your face, in the presence of, you don't recognize him. Meaning you don't recognize me. And this moment, you don't recognize this moment, and you don't inquire of him. And so, inquiring of him is different than asking or demanding for he, Yeshua, to say, who are you? And this is a, you know, an issue. So if you want to know, you see, and ultimately the person is far less than the message they convey. There are many teachers whose life does not equal their teaching, as Ra said. And in many ways, for everybody, all of us who teach or talk will be called teachers, and I don't even hold that so tightly myself, but say what I think is important. Doing teaching, but not self-identified as teacher. I consider that myself. I don't think I'm a teacher. But if you want to evaluate teaching, listen deeply, ponder, contemplate, use your heart, use your logic, use your reason, use your intellect, and your intuition, and your heart, and your feeling, all. Use it all. And come to your own conclusions. And whether the speaker has social position or nothing shouldn't really matter. But for many people who see the outside and don't feel the inside, they don't realize that. And so that's what Yeshua was saying, is you look at the outside, but you can't receive and know the inner. And then it goes on, saying 92, with this whole issue of knowing and how to know, epistemology, or the theory of knowledge, but how it is that people come to know, and sort of a psychoanalysis of human knowledge and determination of what is and what isn't and what's true. The reality that most people look to the outer to determine the inner. Like Heraclitus said, they take the crowd as their teacher. If everybody says it, it must be true. If some person with some social position says it, it must be true. If they have lots of experience or authority, and others look up to them, it must be true. Or it must be important. And Gautama, who was way ahead of all this anyway, basically said, don't believe what I say based on its reasonableness, or based on the honor accorded me by others, or based on your respect for me or your love for me. Don't agree or don't believe what I'm saying simply based on who I am, what I am, where I am, what others think, and even the fact that it may be reasonable. take it to yourself and think about it and feel it. And he didn't say feel it, he said really ponder, contemplate, know it for yourself, come to your own conclusions. And so don't believe it because you respect me or like me, or others like me or respect me, or I have some title or some authority, or even that it makes sense. Just because it makes sense, it doesn't mean it's true. There are lots of things that make sense, like psychological interpretation. Oh, you're just saying that because you're jealous. Well, just because it's true of one, it may not be true of another. And just because it's true in one case for one person doesn't mean it's true tomorrow for the same person. And just because it's reasonable doesn't mean it's true. So knowing is a piece of work, you know. And if you don't make effort, you won't get it. So saying 92, Yeshua said, seek and you will find. In the past, I did not tell you the things about which you asked me. Now I am willing to tell you, but you do not seek them. And so this is the Thomas Gospel origin of that very famous teaching, seek and you will find. Now we go to Lambden. Jesus said, seek and you will find. Yet, what you asked me about in former times, and which I did not tell you then, now I do desire to tell you, but you do not inquire after it. What that is, of course, I don't know. And so, the reason that people are so confused and conflicted about this and that, or what is true, is because of inadequate seeking. Seeking, you will find, is absolutely the law. Just like the secret, you know. If you want, it's the law of attraction. Attracting knowledge by focused, consistent, persistent seeking of it. Seeking attracts and magnetizes and materializes that which is sought. And so, what a man has is what a man has sought. How a person lives is the result of the composite or synthesis of all levels of their seeking, body, mind, spirit. And so the one that has discernment is the one that has been seeking truth and knowledge and understanding deeply. Like Gautama said, the karmic root of discernment is consistent seeking of asking of the wise and the worthy, what's in my long-term welfare and benefit? Not short-term, long-term. And not only seeking you will find, but the degree of seeking translates or becomes the degree of what's found. There are people who know a little. There are people who know a lot. There are people with great discernment. There are people with poor discernment. We have great discernment in one area. We may have poor discernment in another. It's all a matter of the quality, quantity, intensity, degree, nature, and specific qualities of the seeking. And so the people who have a lot of money are those who have been seeking a lot of money, generally. The people who can access great wisdom, they don't have it. Nobody has it. They don't have wisdom, but they can access or receive, transmit profound wisdom, have been seeking that. So 92 from Bernard says, Yeshua, seek and you shall find, but those things did you ask me about them in those days, did not I tell them to you in the day which they're that? Now desire I to tell them, and you inquire not after them. And so again, that's something specific that some disciples, in this case, I guess, asked about before. He didn't say, now he's willing to say, but they're not seeking. that's another principle or psychodynamic that happens individually and collectively, is when it's available, we don't want it. When it's not available, we want it. When it's not available, or when we want it, it's not available, and it is available later, but we've changed our mind. Sometimes, of course, that's completely natural. I no longer seek it, what I had sought before, because somehow there's fulfillment without it. But in this case, we're talking about seeking and knowing, seeking and finding, leading to knowing and wisdom, praying for discernment, the results of discernment. But in this case, whatever it is, it's certainly not unusual that people can, some people, some of us, sometimes we get stuck into a loop where we're wanting when what we seek is unavailable, and when and what is available we don't seek. And so there, this is a sort of self-sabotage, you can say, but there is a psychopathology to it sometimes, obviously, where, like Groucho said, you know, I don't want to join any club that would have me. There's a little low self-worth, or there's some self-doubt going on, perhaps, in persistently directing our attention to seek what's not available, and persistently not appreciating what is available. In the Bailey material, there's some notion that humanity has far, far more good karma, so-called, than bad. And that's an interesting point. You can look at the world and say, wow, how what bad karma these folks have. On the other hand, the world or humanity, even technology, civilization, is rich, rich, rich with bounties and boon and blessing. But people don't appreciate that, right? Do you appreciate plumbing? Do you appreciate electricity and air conditioning? Or nice shoes and socks? Do you appreciate, you know, the taste of your meal, each meal? Or is your mind busy looking, running somewhere else? So, 93, more about this issue of seeking, finding, what's available, what's not available. 93 also relates to some famous gospel passage. Do not give what is holy to dogs. They might throw them upon the manure pile. Do not throw pearls to swine. They might make mud of it. So don't throw pearls to pigs. They may muck it up. Don't give the holy to the lowly. They may throw them into the shit, you know? Don't give something precious to somebody who doesn't appreciate it. And that may be why Yeshua didn't give what they wanted or were seeking in those earlier days. They weren't worthy or ready. Worthy really means ready. And yet now they may be ready and no longer value it. 93 from Lambden. Jesus said, "Do not give what is holy to dogs, lest they throw them on the dung heap. Do not throw the pearls to swine, lest they it dot dot dot." So that just shows you that Mr. Lambden is a little more honest and accurate than Mr. Meyer, because obviously the saying was fragmented. So when we look to Bernhard 93, we see, not do to give that which is sacred to the dogs, so that not they cast them to the dung heap. Not do to cast the pearls to the swine, so that not they make them made broken in pieces. And so, don't give the sacred to dogs. I mean, you know, some dogs are very sweet, but we're not talking about sweet, you know, harvestable dogs. We're talking about those that can't appreciate the beauty, the preciousness, the sanctity of a particular offering. Don't give that which is precious to those that don't appreciate. And similar, because they will throw them away. Likewise, pearls to swine or pigs. That's the thing. Everybody translated as swine. How about pigs? Don't throw pearls to pigs, because they'll break them. And this is not love or wisdom, but wisdom over love, or love and wisdom well balanced. It's nice that everybody everybody lives in the sacred, but some people reject the sacred. Some people hate the sacred. I mean, there are people around who hate God, or they hate the idea of God, or they say there's no God and they hate that whole idea. So, what is appropriate to give to them? So Ra said to those who are sleeping, we simply let them sleep, help them to sleep more comfortably, not wake them up, not bother them with metaphysics. If they want to sleep, let them sleep. If they want to hate, let them hate. If they want to roll in the mud, let them roll in the mud. If they think, religiosity, spirituality, metaphysics is all bunk and fantasy, so be it. More power to you, baby. Have a good time. Have a good time. And after you die, you'll see. So, no problem. No problem. It's very good to let people be as they are. I mean, of course, if they're harming you or people you love, it's a different story. But it's better to let it's better to let people be as they are than force them to be that which we feel would be better for them. Right? Giving, why even think of giving holy, what's holy to dogs? Because I want to help the dogs. Or those pigs would look better in pearls, so think I. Well, sometimes we shouldn't be giving unless they want or ask. And sometimes when they want, we still shouldn't give. Right? So if somebody wants something precious and doesn't appreciate it and wants to muck it up or hurt you or hurt themselves, better to say no, thank you. I can't give. So I think there's some subtle points here. 94, Yeshua said, one who seeks will find. For one who knocks, it will be opened. From Lambden, Jesus said, he who seeks will find, and he who knocks will be let in. And so again, it's the same notion that the universe is a kindly place, and energy follows thought. And so if one's intention directs fashions thought of certain goals and objectives that one seeks, seeking knowledge, seeking material gain, seeking social position, seeking wisdom, seeking discernment, seeking purification, seeking contact with Godhead or higher dimensional beings, or seeking peace and love and healing. What you seek, you can find. Now, obviously, lots of people do a lot of seeking and don't find a lot of what they're looking for. Why? Well, you gotta look at the case. Sometimes there are problems in the seeking. Sometimes there's incarnational karma that's not being recognized that supersedes even purified seeking. Even the best of seeking is trumped by program catalyst incarnational karmic limitations. And so that's another matter. He who knocks will be let in eventually. That's true. 94, interlinear, says Yeshua, he who seeks, he shall find, and he who knocks inward, they shall open to him. And that, it's, so it's not just he who knocks, it's he who knocks inward. Is this what, knocking yourself? No, it's sort of knocking to go in, or knocking to enter. They shall open to him, meaning those in the room, one seeks entry, into which one seeks entry. So, where you seek to enter, at least in the spiritual perspective here, eventually will be open to let you in, but you have to be qualified or self-qualify. And so Ra said, wisdom is a rather lonely matter. And there's a lot of there are many, the higher the office, the greater the qualifications, the more purified the space one seeks entry into, the more self-developed or greater the commitment to purification needs to be. And particularly, there's the purification of intention, where some forms of seeking are considered less beneficial and less valuable than others, right? So there's seeking in the realm of the lower triad, and there's seeking in the realm of the higher triad. Lower triad chakras 1, 2, 3. Higher triad chakras, we can say, 4, 5, 6. So there's seeking outward, there's seeking for the worldly winds of pleasure and material gain and praise and honor. There's seeking for qualities of love and green ray, and qualities of wisdom, discernment, truth, knowing, blue ray, and seeking illumination, clarity, awareness of reality beyond thought, six ray, indigo. And so, wherever you direct your energy by intention, or wherever you're focused intentionally, there too shall go your energy, your attention, and time, and results will happen there. So, moving on. 95, Yeshua said, "If you have money, do not lend it at interest, but give it to someone from whom you will not get it back." And so this is perhaps a recommendation that, or a statement that charity or free giving is superior morally to lending money at interest, which is called usury, which is just business. So there's no, if the giving entails some kind of material exchange, then it really can't be called charity, right? The idea that the merchants and the banking and the bankers are some kind of benevolent force in society is a big joke, actually, obviously not. But Yeshua is saying, if you have something valuable, don't try to get something. If you really want purified giving, ask for nothing in return. Simply give it. Give it to somebody who will not give it back to you. 95 Lambden, Jesus said, "If you have money, do not lend it at interest, but give it to one from whom you will not get it back." Almost the same as Meyer. And Bernhard, interlinear, says Yeshua, "If you have copper coins, not due to lend at the usury, but rather give them to him who you will, to him who you will receive them not from hand his." And so, none of these translators seem to understand the value of literal translation, except for Bernard. And so, it wasn't money, it was copper coins. Of course, that means money, or currency, or, value in society. Why not say copper coins? Because they think you can't handle it. Because they think you won't understand. So, the arrogance of translators, or the insecurity of translators, or the dishonesty of translators, or the lack of moral commitment of translators, or the mixed motives of translators. They did great in translating. So much we wouldn't have this. I have a lot of appreciation that they did all their work in translation. And when it comes down to it, they're not, they don't have a tight commitment, actually, to the original. They have some commitment, they have a strong commitment, but they think they know better than you, generally. So be careful, you know? I mean, I think everybody's capable of anything. But I'll try to be a, I try to quote Ra directly and Gautama. And I think I've failed if I don't. So, says Aram, Aram is the Coptic for Yeshua. Aram, "If you have copper coins, don't lend at the usury." Uh-oh, he really said usury. So again, both translators, Meyer and Lambden, think that you shouldn't hear that, or it wouldn't help you, or you can't understand, or let's not talk about Jesus and usury. But he said, if you have copper coins, don't lend at usury, meaning lending to get money or interest back, but rather give them to him who you will receive them, to him who receives them, who from him whom you will you won't get them back. You will not, you won't receive them back from his hand. From the hand of the one you give to will not be given back to you. That's the one to give to, your copper coins. And so the value of free giving and the you know, the sin of usury. Usury is considered a super sin, particularly in Islam, called the riba. And even Islamic banks do interest in this world. So, you know, the idea, the original quote is not that money is the root of all evil. It's the love of money is the root of all evil. It's not money that's the problem. It's the valuation of money superior to love, wisdom, truth, harmony, peace, well-being, cooperation, and, you know, peace and plenty, prosperity for all. It's the love, it's the greed, it's greed, the greed-based use of money that may be considered the root of all evil, or a root of evil in human civilization. The greater, the deeper root, of course, is Orion 40 negative and the requirements of the service help path. 96. Yeshua said, the Father's kingdom is like a woman who took a little yeast, hid it in dough, and made large loaves of bread. Whoever has ears should hear. So the Father's kingdom, the sovereignty, kingdom of heaven within and without, like a woman with a little yeast hiding it or putting it into dough, and then creates many, you know, many large loaves. A little yeast can feed many, or that which is small growing far larger and providing nourishment to many. And so Yeshua is talking about the Logos, or the Heavenly Father, one infinite creator, the author of cosmic plan, and the author of the plan and the structure of soul evolution, being profoundly loving and caring and offering so that all may be nourished. And from a little comes a lot, from that which is small comes that which is capable of nourishing countless beings. All the rivers come from the mountain pool, that kind of thing. So from Lambden, Jesus said, the kingdom of the Father is like a certain woman. She took a little leaven, concealed it in some dough, and made it into large loaves. Let him who has ears hear. And from Bernard's Interlinear, says Yeshua, the sovereignty of the Father, it is like a woman. Did she take a little leaven? Did she hide it in dough? Did she make it into some large loaves? He who has ears to him, let him hear. So taking a little yeast or leaven, putting it, hiding it in dough, you see, it's not clear whether it's hide or not, but it's certainly push, you put within and therefore be concealed to then make many, many loaves. And so there's the concealment of the small that has great spiritual potency that leads to, or being the basis of great quantity manifestation for spiritual nourishment, great quantity of spiritual nourishment to feed or provide many. And you can say Yeshua, you know, Yeshua himself is like that seed or leaven that is the basis of that hidden and unseen becomes the basis of spiritual nourishment for millions and millions, hundreds of millions actually, since his time. And so the sovereignty of the Father, the kingdom of heaven, or the nature of higher chakras, or the work of the Confederation and the Council, the work of all true servers, world servers or helpers, is great, the un, often unseen great of great potential, manifesting the small, the unseen small of great potential, manifesting hugely as spiritual nourishment for many. In some ways, the whole universe is like that. That's cosmic plan. 97, starting with Meyer, Yeshua said, "The Father's kingdom is like a woman who was carrying a jar full of meal. While she was walking along a distant road, the handle of the jar broke, and the meal spilled behind her along the road. She did not know it. She noticed no problem. When she reached her house, she put the jar down and found it empty." So now, this emptying of this unrecognized progressive emptying of a jar of meal meaning like ground flour or ground grain becoming flour. How can we say that's like the Father's kingdom? Well, I'm not sure. But you can say that she lost her meal, her nourishment. You can say that she also unknowingly offered it to all or offered it to many. There is certainly a full emptying out of that which is valuable. Now, for the woman, it seems like a loss, unrecognized loss. Is that what's being said or being alluded to here? I'm not sure. Go to Lambden 97. The kingdom of the Father is like a certain woman who was carrying a jar full of meal. While she was walking on the road, still some distance from home, the handle of the jar broke, and the meal emptied out behind her on the road. She did not realize it. She had noticed no accident. When she reached her house, she set the jar down and found it empty. So she didn't know. It's emptied out. The handle broke, or that which allows the carrying of the nourishment. Is this a problem or it's not a problem? It's a problem for her. How is the kingdom of the Father a problem then? Or a loss of what's valuable? Certainly, it's an emptying out of that which is valuable for all to take. I'm not sure that's what's being alluded to here. So let's look at the interlinear. Says Yeshua, "The sovereignty of the Father, it is like a woman. She is carrying a jar, it full of grain." So that it wasn't even meal, it's grain. "Was she walking upon a road? It is distant. Did the handle of the jar break? Did the grain pour out after her upon the road? Was she recognizing not to be? Was not she noticing problem? Did she become to arrive into her house? Did she put the jar to the ground? Did she find it is empty? She didn't notice. So I'm really not sure, because either we're saying that this is a problem, or this is not a problem, or it's a problem for her, but a boon and blessing to those who found it. So it's a problem for the one that owned it. It's a problem according to common notions of ownership, meaning she lost her what she owned. It's also a problem for her personally and her accumulation and her survival. Or is she gonna eat the grain or die? So it's a problem for her. It's also perhaps a statement against human ownership. But you can say it's a boon or a blessing for all those who may have found the grain on the road. But it's certainly not a story of not noticing the loss of something valuable. Now, how that is, the story of humanity. But how that is akin to the sovereignty of the father, I'm not really sure, because I don't think the father has lost something. However, we saw with the Valentinian Gospel of Truth, there is a certain kind of loss of creation itself is a loss from the view of those who have not yet returned to the Father, or from the view of the Father or the One Infinite Creator that wishes that all beings seek and become one or be well and happy. There's a lot of pain and suffering in the creation of beings. So there's a loss of purity or a loss of joy, sanctity. There is a broken vessel in the sense that beings of the octave don't know who they are, don't know where they're from, don't know where they're going, or haven't finished yet. There is a creation as the return of a prodigal son, or the mending of what has been broken, or the returning, particularly actually in mind, in awareness, to the original condition, the original desires of entities seek and become one, or seek and return to the awareness of the one they've always been, but forgot. And so this may be akin to this may be some of the basis for this saying 97, in that in terms of awareness of unity and sanctity, the creation of the of infinite beings are swimming in the ocean of birth and death, and still are experiencing dukkha, suffering, stress, and still are born and die and not returned yet to the original state from which they emerged, or the original state that they are, but have forgotten and lost, or lost by forgetting. So that there may be something related there. 98, starting with Meyer. Yeshua said, "The Father's kingdom is like a person who wanted to put someone powerful to death. While at home, he drew his sword and thrust it into the wall to find out whether his hand would go in. Then he killed the powerful person." So we got some pretty divergent analogies here. A person wants to put somebody else to death, a powerful person. At home, he practices, draws the sword, thrusts it into the wall to see if he's going to do it, whether he could do it, and then he did it to that person. From Lambden, Jesus said, 98, "The kingdom of the Father is like a certain man who wanted to kill a powerful man. In his own house, he drew his sword and stuck it into the wall in order to find out whether his hand could carry through. Then he slew the powerful man." So there is one person who wants to kill a powerful person, who practices at home first with his sword in his hand to see if he can do it. He could, I guess, and then he does it. What in the world does that mean? It's certainly associated with the action of one at a lower level of society to somebody at a higher level, the action of a lower social position person to terminate the life of someone at a higher position, but practicing it first, and I can't say I understand how that's like the kingdom of the Father. But let's go to the abstract or interlinear. Says Yeshua, the sovereignty of the father. It is like a father, it is like a person. He is desiring to kill a person eminent. Did he draw forth the sword in his house? Did he pierce it into the wall so that he would ascertain whether his hand would prevail? Then did he slay the eminent person. So it's eminent person, which is socially prominent, you can say. I can't say I understand the analogy here, but is it a good thing or a bad thing that the eminent person was slain by the person who first practiced at home? I don't know. Depends. This is probably very specific to a real-life situation that Yeshua encountered or the disciples encountered or was going on at the time. So we just don't know. I don't know whether it's considered a good thing or a bad thing to have done this. Is it it's an eminent person? Is he an evil person? Is he a good person? Is this an act of protecting the beloved? Or is it an act of harming a good one? Hard to say. But certainly, the kingdom of the Father being not simply... what is the kingdom of the Father, right? The kingdom of heaven is within. What is within? Within what? Within my body? No. Within my mind? Well, mind is not a thing that has an inner and an outer. So you see, it's immediately Buddhist throws it out. And so what is the kingdom of heaven? Well, or the sovereignty of the Father? Well, you can say it's the realm, it begins, or it's associated with the way of the higher chakras or fourth, fifth, sixth dimensional life. It's conscious living and being in love, universal compassion, and wisdom, discernment, knowing, and awareness of unity, and awareness of sanctity and divinity, awareness of all the functions of love, wisdom, and the awareness of unity, sanctity, is an experiential kingdom of heaven. Surely it's associated with fourth, fifth, sixth density, higher dimensions on the positive side. You can say it's associated with the basis of the octave. Intelligent energy came out of the Logos, or the Heavenly Father is different than the Logos, and so the kingdom of the Father, it could be called all creation. The one infinite creator is Heavenly Father. The kingdom of the Father is all octaves. All octaves, all dimensions, all realms is the kingdom or the realm created by Heavenly Father or Intelligent Infinity. And so, nobody wants to think too deeply here in this world. Not many people. And yet we can't understand anything unless we pull apart these concepts and look in. I mean, we really walk around, everybody walks around in this world not knowing even what they're talking about, even what they mean, or what they're, focused upon in discussion. We generally know only the surface and most superficial knowing, very shallow. We it's like some accomplishment to put concepts together, but none of those concepts are profoundly comprehended. None of, let alone the reality that the concepts point to. So there's the reality that let's say metaphysical concepts point to, like love, wisdom, discernment, unity, non-duality. There's the reality that's being pointed to by the concepts. And yet, if we don't explore or dive deep into a more profound understanding of the concepts themselves, we think we know, but we don't. And like that, even the kingdom of heaven within. It ain't within the body. It ain't within the mind. It's not a place. It's within and without. And it's associated with time space, and it's not associated with time space. It's before time and space, and it's a certain attitude of mind that perceives time and space. So it's much more, all these things are much more subtle than most everyone recognizes. 99, moving along from Meyer, and then I'm going to end in a couple after here in the next one. The student said to him, "Your brothers and your mother are standing outside." He said to them, "Those here who do the will of my Father are my brothers and my mother. They will enter my Father's kingdom." From Lambden, the disciple said to him, 99, "Your brothers and your mother are standing outside." He said to them, "Those here who do the will of my Father are my brothers and my mother. It is they who will enter the kingdom of my Father." And so then we can say kingdom of my Father, the sovereignty, kingdom of heaven, is here identified as a time-space realm, as a realm, a domain, a place, even if it's a, you know, spatio-temporal or temporo-spatial domain or realm or dimension or density, we can say, they enter the kingdom. Well, the kingdom, it may be understood again as development of qualities of mind-body-spirit complex, or development of qualities of mind-heart-spirit, development of qualities of fourth and fifth and sixth chakra as they pertain to sentience, and also higher dimensions, and also the basis or root of all dimensionalities as well, for those who wish to look deeply. And so Yeshua is really saying, my biological brothers and mother are not my true family, brothers and mother. My true family is spiritual, not biological. And so it was a very critical portion of Yeshua's ministry or work to revalue sanctity and path from biological racial to spiritual universal, and external tribal to internal ideological moral. His family, his true family, is not biological, it's spiritual ideological moral. And so those who do the will of my Father, what is that? Well, the will to know, the will to develop the higher triad, the will to seek and become one, the will to develop virtue and gnosis and be of benefit to self and other and all. How about that? Those who are committed to that are my true family, my true comrades, and those that gave birth to me too, even, like mother. They enter the kingdom of my Father, or they will receive the kingdom, or receive the blessings of love light. Say, looking, and I think we'll end here, concluding here with 99, saying 99 from the interlinear, say the disciples to him, "Thy brothers with thy mother, they are standing on feet theirs, out of the side outer," outside the house. Says he to them, "Those who within these places, who are doing the volition of my Father, these are my brothers with my mother. Themselves they are who shall go into the sovereignty of my Father." And so, I guess this was just an incident where brothers of Yeshua and mother on their feet standing outside, and he's saying, no, those within, not outside, and those here doing the work, or the will, doing the volition, the will or intention of the Creator of Love Light. These are my true family. And Orthodox Judaism at that time was very racial, very tribal, very biological, very physical, phenomenal, performance-based, ritualistic. And Yeshua, threw all that away, or said that's not the true way of the Father, source of love, light. The true way of the source of love and light, or the source of light, the kingdom, the source of heaven and earth, being the Father or Tel Infinity or source, its way is not a physical, biological, racial, tribal, ritualistic way. Its way is the way of morality and faith in virtue, wisdom, and it's a community. It's an inward community, not based on birth biology. It's of the mind spirit, not of body, racial, tribal. And so that was a very big deal that he talked that way, and very similar to Gautama, who basically said it doesn't matter what caste you're in, and a high birth Brahmin is not a hero by birth. It's anyone who's done the work of purification of mind, mind heart, who's conquered himself. That one is a hero. That one is a Brahmin. And Gautama many times said the true Brahmin is the one who's purified himself of desires and freed of anger and kleshas. That one is a Brahmin. That is a sage, or that one is a holy man, woman, not the one who by birth. So in many ways, you can say that both Gautama and Yeshua turned against the tribalistic, racialistic, physically focused, orthodoxy, religious, socio-religious, religious-sociological, social orthodoxies of their day, Jewish in Middle East and Brahmanical Hindu at the time of Gautama. And Gautama's teaching was a universal spirituality in the same way as Yeshua. It doesn't matter. Gautama was very open to women also, being taught, not into being monks, however, but he relented and foresaw the problems. But many women were fully enlightened that he taught freely. But becoming a monastic order alongside men was not what he wanted, and became a big problem down the line, obviously, by the fault of the men, generally. But Gautama opened up religiosity, spirituality, path, practice, teaching, training, to all, regardless of caste. And Yeshua also presented a universality of candidacy for the kingdom of heaven, the Father's kingdom, being open to all who had faith and had a commitment to virtue. Virtue and faith. And Gautama was basically virtue and practice, teaching the way of virtue and the practices that goes to prajna, from samadhi to prajna. So that's interesting. Next week we're going to pick up at saying 100, and we may not finish, but I'll discipline myself perhaps to finish the final sayings of Gospel of Thomas. I hope it's been helpful. Thank you so much. Please take good care of yourselves, and good night.